sing and shout the victory.
Say onward to the prize.
Onward to the prize before us. Soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open. We shall tread the streets of gold.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Come on, will you lift your hands with me? Let's just invite the Holy Spirit to have his way in our life here tonight. God, we thank you for this evening. We thank you that we can all come and glorify you and honor you. We ask that you would have your way in our heart. Minister to needs. Let us be lifted up tonight as we laugh and as joy comes into this room. We just give you all glory and all honor, and thank you for all the things you've given us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Why don't you turn around and tell someone you're glad to see him here today.
So I definitely can't sing as high as I'm here. So you're out of the air. Yo. Thank you.
Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We give you all glory, all honor, and all praise. We bless your name. Come on, sing this, every praise.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise
is to our God.
Come on, sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God.
Every praise.
Every praise.
We praise you, we glorify your name. Oh, we give you all glory and all honor, God. There's no one like you, Jesus. We bless your name. We bless your name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Now do that with the fruit of your lips. Come on, give him all the glory, oh, all the praise, all the honor. Oh, that's what we came here to do, to bless your name, God. We bless you. Oh, there's no one like you, Jesus. No one compares to you, Lord. We love you, God. Oh, we give you praise. We give you honor. Hallelujah. Thank you for your glory, God. Thank you for your presence, Jesus. We give you glory. We honor you, God. You are so worthy. We love you, God. We sing how great is our God. We magnify your name, God. Worthy, 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 worthy. Sing, how great is our God.
How great is our God.
Thank you, Father.
I know we serve a mighty God, amen? How many are thankful you serve a great, great God? One more time, let's just lift our hands to Him. Can we do that? Give Him glory. Lord, we just honor you. We praise you. You are so good to us, Lord. Great and mighty God. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and say, we serve a great God, and you may be seated. Praise the Lord. It's good to see you out tonight. We just pray God's richest blessings on your life. We're so thankful that you're with us. We've got an exciting evening planned already, and God's going to do great things around the altar, great things in your heart. I'm sure of it. And it's just good to see you in the house of the Lord. There's a few things coming up you need to know about. And one of the big things is revival starting this next Sunday night. Of course, we've had a spirit of revival around here for 3 or 4 months, but the Sunday night, Steve Furr will be with us Sunday night at 6, Monday night at 7 o'clock. All right, just making sure we're okay. I hear a lot of talking. You guys hear that? My hearing aid's turned up too loud. Do I hear something? I just thought I heard a lot of blah, 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 blah. I'm hearing a lot right now. All right, well, let's bring her down a little bit. Amen. So Sunday night, 6 o'clock, Monday night, 7 o'clock, and then Chad McAtee will be Tuesday, Wednesday, 7 o'clock, and you guys will love him. I'm looking forward to a good time, aren't you? So come on, Pastor Art, tell us about the rest of the stuff going on.
Few things coming up. Men, this Saturday is our men's breakfast at 8:30, so guys, come on out for that. Pastor Mark's mentioned our revival beginning this Sunday, going through Wednesday evening. Youth convention's coming up November 18th to the 19th. Make sure you see Pastor Evan for information about that. Also, this coming Sunday, we'll conclude our Epic Give Focus for Speed the Light. So if you haven't had a chance to give to Speed the Light yet, you can do that either on Sunday or up leading up to that. And then put this on your calendar now, beginning Sunday, November 27th, all the Sundays in December, and Sunday, January 1st, we will have one service at 10 o'clock. So beginning the Sunday after Thanksgiving, all through December, and then the first Sunday in January, one service at 10 o'clock. So don't say we didn't tell you, okay? You know now. You know. I didn't know. Yes, you do. You know right now. So, amen. Come on, stand with me if you would. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer for our offerings this evening. God, we're just so glad to be in your house. You are a great and awesome God, and we worship you, and we continue to worship you in our giving as we bring our tithe and our offerings as we give to missions. Bless the offerings, we pray, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Bring your offering around the front. The missions plate is in the middle.
Hey, once again, thanks for worshiping with us online today. We hope that you're experiencing the presence of the Lord right there at home, wherever you are. Thank you also for your generous giving. We appreciate it so much. Keep up the good work. You guys are doing so good. Just remember, there are three ways that you can give. You can text Spring Hill CC to 77977. Follow the instructions there on how to give. You can also go to our website, springhillchristiancenter.com. Same thing, click the tab to give and just follow the instructions. Or you can drop it by the church or put it in the mail. However you do it, we know that as you continue to give, you're going to be blessed. Don't forget to give to missions. We still have a lot of ministries going on and a lot of missionaries that we're supporting. So once again, thanks for giving.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So our guest here is he's a I said, how exactly do you want me to introduce you, Lee? He goes, just introduce me as a staff evangelist. We've had him with us a lot. We enjoy him being here so much. But if you don't know, this is the first time you've ever heard him. He's opened up for Duck Dynasty at Cabela's, at Pro Bass. When they open a store, he cuts the tape. He's there praying over the building. So would you please give Lee McBride a good Spring Hill welcome.
No, I'm good. It is so good to be here. There's such a excitement in the air. I tell you, you just feel better when you get here. If you have your Bible or your device, turn to Isaiah chapter 40, verses 30 and 31. So I'm a preacher's kid. I grew up in this, just like Mark. And I've been preaching since I was 19 years old. And until the first Monday of June this year, I have never, ever preached Isaiah 40, 30, and 31. I've sang it. I've heard it. I've quoted it. I may have taught a Sunday school lesson on it one time, but I've never preached it. So we have a beach camp every year. It starts the first Monday in June in Panama City Beach called Sold Out. S-O-U-L-E-D, Sold Out. We've been doing it for this will be our 23rd year. We've seen thousands of students come to Christ. So about January every year, I'm the camp pastor, which means I preach on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. I preach the morning sessions, and then I kind of serve as the pastor throughout the whole week. And about January every year, I get the theme. And the theme this year was SOAR. S-O-A-R, SOAR, and this was the theme scripture, Isaiah 40, 30, 31. Now, I'm an evangelist, so I don't have to write many sermons. I've got one sermon called Lost. I've preached it here. I doubt anybody remembers it, about a sheep, a coin, and a son that I, in the last 15 years, have preached 100 times. But when I do write one, it takes months. So you should have deep respect for pastors who have to crank new sermons out every week. And you should never compare a guy, because I'm going to tell you, I preach it 100 times. Around the 50th, 60th time, it gets pretty good. It does. It kind of gets a little better. So, you know, you shouldn't compare those two, but it takes me a long, long time. So I started in January. Let's just read Isaiah 40, 30, 31, and I'll tell you the story. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. I've sang it. I've quoted it. I probably got a picture somewhere in one of those years I was on staff in my office with it on it. Had never preached it. So I began to study the eagle. Now, I don't know if you've done much study on the eagle. I thought, I'm a patriotic guy, I thought I knew a lot about the eagle. I knew nothing about the eagle. And I said, Lord, you didn't put the eagle in there by happenstance. What is it that we can learn from the eagle that can make us run and not grow weary and walk and not faint, that can make us serve God with intensity and passion for our whole life? Never burn out. What is it we can learn from the eagle? So when I began to study the eagle, I started watching documentaries on the eagle. I ordered a couple books on tape about the eagle. I started searching old sermons. And I heard sermons from all over, all different kinds of guys, old guys, young guys, all different denominations on the eagle. And I learned some things about the eagle that can help us tonight renew our strength. Things I did not know. I learned multiple random facts about the eagle. We'll talk about just a few random ones before we get to the three I want to emphasize. I did not know that 80% of every eagle that's born on earth, not just bald eagles, not American eagles, not golden eagles, not black eagles, every eagle born on earth, 80% of them live to be 100 years old. I didn't know that you could take an eagle that's 100 years old and put it on your right arm, and you can take an eagle that's 100 months old and put it on your left arm. And unless you are a specialist that studies eagle, you cannot tell them apart because of their renewal process. I did not know that when an eagle's flying down to pursue food, that he can fly 100 miles an hour. Now, these are going to sound a little hard to believe. I want you to double check me. Don't take my word for it. I didn't know that an eagle from his nest can see a rabbit or a mole or a groundhog in the grass from 2 miles away. I didn't know any of these things about the eagle. So I learned all these random, pretty cool facts about the eagle, but I said, Lord, what is it you're trying to tell us here in Isaiah? What is it that the eagle teaches us? And I found three truths that really helped me, and I want to share them with you tonight, and I think they'll help you. Let's pray. Jesus, we love you so much. Now, Lord, these folks are like family to me, and I love them, and they love me. This church supports me monthly. They believe in what I do. They treat me as if I'm a home missionary. I love these folks, but I don't want that to get in the way of what you might want to say through me tonight. I don't want the familiarity that we have with each other to get in the way. Lord, we don't compare tonight to any other night or day that I've ever been here. But Lord, we just pray that your word will speak to us tonight so that we can run and not grow weary, walk and not faint. All right, so here's what I learned. Every eagle, not some eagles, not most eagles, not the majority of eagles, every eagle born on the earth, immediately after they're born and immediately after they leave their nest, finds a rock. And that rock becomes their rock forever. The whole time they're living, that is their rock. 2 years ago in West Point, Georgia, on Lake West Point, they released 15 golden eagles that had been in captivity, and they had them tracked. They had some way that they could track them, and they went and they found every one of them within 24 hours of their release had found a rock. Now, they used the rock to do a few things. One thing is, a rock is a big part of their renewal process, and that's how they clean, and that's how, when they shed feathers, that's how they clean themselves. They bring moisture, and they put on that rock, and they constantly, constantly are cleaning and renewing themselves. I didn't know this. I didn't know that if an eagle does not have a rock and doesn't take his talons and rub on the rock consistently, that their talons will flatten out and form calcium deposits, and it affects the way they fly. I did not know that every eagle born on earth, not some eagles, not most eagles, every eagle born on earth has 2 exhaust holes in his beak. It's like an exhaust manifold. And if he does not rub that beak on that rock consistently, that those holes will close and it will affect the way he flies. The rock is a very important part of the eagle's renewal process. They must stay close to that rock. They must visit that rock. You and I have a rock, and his name is Jesus Christ. And we must continually be in the renewal process. We must continually stay close to the rock. Now, we grew up in a different day. Pastor Mark and I grew up in a different day. How many of you been in church a long time? Raise your hand if you were in church as children. How many remember a long time ago when they used to preach about hell and the rapture a lot? Raise your hand if you remember that. I spent my whole childhood scared to death I had missed the rapture. Am I the only one? I thought every Sunday night, I thought I'm going to hell. I've missed the rapture. I mean, and to make it worse, they'd send a film through every year called A Thief in the Night. Anybody remember that Thief in the Night film? Does anybody remember the theme song to that thing? There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come. You've been left. Do you know what that'll do to an 11-year-old kid? It'll make him get saved every Sunday night for 15 years. I went to the altar every Sunday night. I was scared to death that the rapture was going to take place and I was going to miss it. I had to come up with a foolproof way to know that I had not missed the rapture. Now, young people, I'm going to talk to you tonight. I want y'all to look at me. All these young people. What is this? All the pretty girls are over here. And there's a pretty girls over there. Why are the dudes over there? Do y'all do that? Do you tell the boys they can't sit by the girls? Great time. Guys, we're going to have a little meeting after church. Look at all those pretty girls. I want to talk to the young people a minute. I'm not the guy that comes and makes fun of your generation. I love your generation. I still preach 5 weeks of youth camp every summer. I love you. I'm not here to make fun of skinny jeans or participation trophies. That's too easy. I'm not going to do that. But I do want to tell you about something that happened to me just to give you some perspective. And these people will be my witnesses. So I want to say this to you, students, and it's going to be hard to believe. But when we were children and our parents bought a television, there was no remote. TVs had no remote. We were the remote. Has anybody ever been called from the outside of the house to the inside of the house to change the channel for your daddy? Raise your hand if you've ever done it before. Matter of fact, at my house, we had HD TV in the 70s. Now, there were not many people had HD TV in the early 70s. But what would happen for us to get HD TV, it meant I was going to have to get on the roof. And my dad is watching the TV, and he's hollering to my brother. My brother's relaying the message, turn it a little more. It's still fuzzy. Out there adjusting that antenna. Has anybody ever put tin foil on a rabbit ear? Yeah. All right, so young people, TVs had no remotes. Now listen to me, go with me. There were only three channels. Three, she grabbed, she went, three channels. All right, let me tell you something else, young people. Listen to me, there were no cell phones, obviously. And we only had one phone in our houses. And it was in the middle of the house, and it had no caller ID. We used to have to answer the phone every time it rang. You couldn't shady button nobody. You couldn't screen your calls because we had no idea who was calling. There was no way to tell. It was one rotary phone in the middle of all our houses, and it weighed 37 pounds. And we had a cord in it as long, it was about an acre and a half long. You could walk that phone to the stop sign and back, but you had no idea who was calling. So here's what I did. Right next to our phone was our church directory. And when my parents would say, we're going to run an errand, and we'll be back in about 20 minutes, and they're not back in 22 minutes, you know what song hit my head? There's no time to change your mind. Your mom and daddy gone. You've been left behind. I would take that church directory. We have one lady in our church. if anybody was going to heaven, I knew Sister Nellie Grindle was going to heaven. You say, how'd you know? She had a going to heaven hairdo. Anybody remember the Pentecostal bun, huh? Hers was so tight she couldn't blink. She was also the church siren. Now, you may not know what that means. On the third song every Sunday night, Nellie Grindle's going to stand up and go, whoo! Once that siren went off, anything could happen. I loved her dearly. She truly was a godly woman, and I knew she was never going to miss the rapture. So when that song hit my head and my parents weren't back, I would take her phone number and dial it on that rotary phone. I'd put the phone to my ear. When she answered, I would hang up and say, thank you, Jesus. If Nellie Grindle's still here, I'm still good. Here's a bad byproduct that came out of that generation. I'm not blaming any preacher. My dad was my pastor, my teenage years. I'm not blaming anybody. But we began to view the word repentance as a word of failure or as a dirty word. And we did not emphasize enough that Jesus Christ on the cross paid for our ability to repent, and that we need to do it daily, and that if we don't do it consistently, it's going to affect the way we walk. It's going to affect our walk with God. It's going to affect the way we run. Repentance is not a failure. Repentance is not a term of failure, nor is it a dirty word. Repentance is something Christ bought for us so that we can renew our strength. He is our rock, and we can go to the rock and be clean and be free from sin. Some of you have landed on the wrong rock. You think our mission in this world is to keep our sin secret and private and put something else on social media that makes us look good. But that's a catastrophe waiting to happen. We have to constantly stay rubbing our talons on the rock. We have to constantly be cleansing ourselves on the rock that we know is Jesus Christ. We can walk fully into the presence of God because of what Christ has done for us. Every eagle has a rock. Now, I did not know this. I never knew this about an eagle. That every eagle, not some eagles, not most eagles, every eagle born on earth has a built-in pair of Costa Del Mar sunglasses. Some of you probably got expensive sunglasses. I got a pair one time for Father's Day. 2 weeks later, I sat on them and crushed them. $220 sunglasses. My whole family chipped in to get them for me. I sent them to Oakley. They sent them back. They fixed them, sent them back. 2 weeks later than that, I lost them. I don't get the expensive sunglasses no more. I go to Dollar General and get a $9 pair of sunglasses. And if I lose them, it hurts a little bit, but not near as bad. Every eagle is born with shades built into the side of his eyes. And the reason that is, I didn't know this. I don't know that I've ever seen one of these. I didn't know they existed. It sounds prehistoric a little bit, but there is a bird that flies in the air that's bigger than an eagle and faster than an eagle and can kill an eagle in the air apart from one fact. If this fact was not true, they could kill eagles, but they can't because of this fact. Here's what an eagle will do. The bird's called a condor. I don't know if I've ever even seen a condor. I didn't even know they existed. When a condor begins to pursue an eagle in the air, the eagle closes the shades and flies straight up directly into the sun. And the condor may be bigger and faster, but the closer the eagle gets, the condor's eyes begin to burn and he has to bail out. When the eagle flies directly toward the sun, the condor cannot pursue him. We have the ability to go directly toward God's Son, Jesus Christ. Now, there are a lot of things that are true about our relationship with Jesus, but if that was the only thing that was true, is that when our enemy pursues us, we can go somewhere that he cannot go. That's a beautiful truth. Now, some of you years ago, I don't know if they still do them. I don't know if y'all still do them here. But we grew up in the time of Easter cantata. I wonder what that word means, cantata. Y'all remember Easter cantatas? They were a big deal, weren't they? I was at one in Montgomery when I was in Bible college. I attended an Easter service. I was sweet on this little girl. She lived in Montgomery. It was spring break, so I went to her church. And it was a big church. Really big church. And they had an Easter cantata Easter Sunday night. And I mean, it was packed. And they had a big baptistry built way up into the top of the stage. And they took stones and they made that baptistry the tomb. And they had it rigged with a line that when they sing, "Arise, my love, arise, my love," that Jesus would come out of the tomb on that guide wire and fly over them into heaven. To make the tomb look like clouds, they put dry ice in the baptistry. They didn't practice it, and nobody knew that dry ice in a closed, concealed area is very potent. And it knocked Jesus cold smooth out. I mean, out. And when they arise, my love, Jesus came out the guide wire dead as a hammer. Just wet rag. You know, there are some truths that happened during the crucifixion and resurrection that we don't talk about a lot. I never saw in an Easter cantata the replica or the replay of the innermost part of the temple. And in this little room in the most center part of the tabernacle, there was this room called the Holy of Holies. And in that room is where the Shekinah of glory of God existed. So if we lived during those times, here's what would happen. If we wanted forgiveness for our sin, our high priest would go into that room one day a year. And if he went into that room with sin in his heart, it would kill him. They wouldn't even go retrieve him if he died. They tied a rope around his ankle. And if he died, they would pull him out and anoint someone else high priest. That was how we received forgiveness for sin. But at the point of crucifixion, when Jesus died, I never saw this in an Easter play, but here's what happened. The Bible says the curtain that served as the entrance to the Holy of Holies was torn from the top to the bottom. And you say, "Lee, why is that a big deal?" Well, here's why it's a big deal. I studied the curtain. I studied reputable commentators and theologians about the curtain. And there's a little difference, but we know at least the curtain was 4 feet wide. It was at least 12 inches thick. And at the very least, it was 40 feet high. Now, there's not 20 men in Mooresville, Indiana, that could tear that curtain. But when Christ breathed his last breath, that curtain was torn from the top to the bottom. And the reason it was is because God wanted to show us, because of what the Paschal Lamb did, we can walk directly into the presence of God. Old Testament heroes could not do that. We don't need a high priest. We can enter into the presence of God. So if the enemy is pursuing you, I would say walk directly to the Son. He can't do that. Walk directly into the presence of God. We renew our strength. And those are two pretty good preaching points. That's two pretty powerful truths. And I said, Lord, those are good. But I still don't see how can we do this forever? How can we run and not grow weary, walk and not faint? How can we live this intense chase of God and not give up and not burn out? And I was almost ready to give up. I needed a third point. Man, I had studied and read and watched documentaries. And somebody said, hey, I heard you're studying the eagle. I said, yeah. He sent me a link. And there was an old Native American Indian pastor on an Indian reservation in North Carolina. And I heard him say this. And when he said that, I double checked him, and this is what he said, and it is true. When you see an eagle that is in flight, when you see an eagle that is in the air, not most eagles, not some eagles, every eagle born on this earth, when they are in flight, they are only exerting any energy 10% of the time. 90% of the time, they learn to yield to the wind. They mount their wings. And the stronger the wind, the better they fly. If a storm comes, a hurricane, a tornado, any bad storm comes, they mount their wings and they soar above the storm. You can fly a lot better if you're only exerting your energy 10% of the time, and we are yielding to the wind and the leading of the Holy Spirit. You know, everybody's got a car out there. Everybody's here either row with somebody or you have a car. And tonight, in a few minutes, when we get through, you're going to go home. I don't know what your process at night is. Some of you are going to go home, and you're going to put some microwave popcorn in. And you'll get your comfortable PJs on. And you're going to kick your feet up for a minute, and just you're just going to chillax before you go to bed. Some of you are going to go through the drive-thru. You're starving right now. You're looking at me like, Big Lee, it's a good word, hurry up. I need some chicken fingers. Because you know when this many Christians get together, chickens must die. You do know that. I read that in the third chapter of the KFC version. I did. So you got two options after this is over. When you leave, you can go out there and you can crank your car or your truck or your minivan or your SUV. You can crank it and drive it home. Or you can put the key in, put it in neutral, and push it home. I highly suggest driving it home. It's quicker, it's easier, it's better, it's much more effective. When we learn to trust upon the Lord and yield to the wind of the Holy Spirit, and when we have much more faith in His strength than in our strength, we can run and not grow weary, and we can walk and not faint. Here's the key. You have to yield to the wind of the Holy Spirit. We have to. We like to fix our own problems. We like to make our own plans. We like to do what we think we ought to do. We like to develop our own strategies. But really, what we need to do is learn to yield to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Pastor Mark took me back there and we walked through the what's happening down there. It's going to be the new sanctuary. I was so excited. I don't know if he knows, but I caught this. We were walking back up. I was like, Pastor Mark, whose idea was this? I mean, how did this come about? You know what he said? He said, for years, I've always thought it would be good to turn this into a sanctuary. So if he's known it for years, it would have been tempting at many points before now to go ahead and do it. But you know what he did? He waited for the timing of the Lord. And there's no doubt this church could have done that. There's two or three points since I've been here you could have done it. But he waited, he yielded to the leading of the Holy Spirit. And now, on Easter Sunday, there are going to be 600 people in that new room. And there are going to be names written in the book of life. And people are going to have hope who didn't have hope before they came to this church. Because we yield to the wind. I prayed with a guy not long ago. He said, Big Lee, I need you to pray for my side. So what's on? He said, man, we are under the gun financially. I said, man, I'm so sorry. How can I help you pray? He said, man, you know, I got a little extra money during COVID, and we bought a lake house, and then I had to buy a pontoon boat for my lake house, and then we both got new cars. And, you know, we're just really having trouble paying for it. And I thought, buddy, you got the cart before the horse. I said, there's no doubt God will deliver us when we sabotage ourselves. But what would have been better is if we'd have prayed for God's timing and his will, for you went out and put your life on the line. We yield to the wind and we obey the leading of the Holy Spirit. Stand with me tonight, if you will. Right where you are, stand with me. Sister, will you come play something for us? It ain't got to be loud. You don't even have to sing. Just play something for us. Now, this is a little different. If you've heard me preach before, this one's a little different. But there is no doubt in my mind that this is the word for tonight in this room. You say, Lee, that sounds a little arrogant. It's not arrogance. Sometimes you don't know. And I'll be honest with you, sometimes you miss. But when you've been chasing God about his will, what to preach, as long as I have, sometimes you do know. This word was for somebody here tonight. You're pushing your car. You're trying to do things out of just sheer discipline or your own strength. And what you need to do is stay close to the rock. Matter of fact, right here, every head up, every eye open. If you're in here tonight, and when I began to talk about repentance, the Holy Spirit tugged on your heart about something in your life that needs to be clean, needs to be made right, because it is affecting the way you fly. It's affecting your walk with God. If that's you, just raise your hand where you are. Big Lee, that's me tonight. I got something weighing on my heart. Just wherever you are, just slip your hand right up and right back down. You know who you are. If you need prayer for that, here's the beautiful, if that's your issue, here's the beautiful thing about that. God's already promised us in Scripture he would forgive you and he would cleanse you. The Scripture very plainly says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from unrighteousness. So if that's you, I know this takes a little courage and a little boldness. Would you come tonight so we could pray with you? Just right now. Don't even wait on nobody else. If you got something in your heart that needs to be made right, because you don't want the talons to form calcium deposits. You want to stay crisp and fresh before the Lord. If that's you, you need to be cleansed. You need to be renewed. I want you to come. It takes a little bit of courage, especially to be the first one. But if the Holy Spirit's tugging on your heart, I want you to come tonight. I don't do this a lot, but I feel led to do this. Why don't you just quietly and reverently offer to the person on your left and your right, offer them this. If you need to go and you don't want to go alone, I'll go with you. Do that right now. If anybody needs to make their heart right before God, if you need to repent of something, if it's affecting your walk with God, and if they need you to come with them, come on. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. If you're here tonight, hey, praise you, Jesus. I'll be right with you. If you're here tonight and you need to go directly to the Son, the enemy is pursuing you. You know, the Old Testament, there's a scripture that says, when the enemy comes against us like a flood, that means wave after wave. You fight off one wave, here comes another. The Bible says God will raise a standard up against him. If that's you, you need to put those shades on and fly directly to the Son. I want you to come right now. Lee, I need freedom over something in my life. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Just come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is so good to see that the ladies tonight in the room have the courage to make a move. If you've kind of been trying to do things in your own plan, you're carrying out your own strategy, and you think, Lee, I just need to yield to the wind. I'm pushing the car. I'm trying to do things out of my own strengths. I'm a little too self-sufficient. I need to be frail and dependent when it comes to hoping and leaning and trusting on God. I need to hear His will and yield to the wind of the Holy Spirit. If that's you, would you come tonight? Would you come? Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. All right, me and Pastor Mark are going to pray with these people. Why can we sing that? I said we didn't need to sing, but can we sing I Surrender All? Here's the issue on my mind.
Savior, I
Lift your hands with me, sing it. To thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender. Come on, sing again. Oh, I surrender all.
I surrender.
Come on, don't sing it. Make this your prayer. God, I surrender everything. I surrender to you, Lord. I surrender all to thee,
my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
Come on, just let him know, Lord, we love you. We honor you. We give you glory, Lord. You're so good to us. Thank you, Lord, that we can mount up with wings like eagles, run and not be weary, walk and not faint. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 How many are thankful for the grace and love and mercy of God? Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a good clap offering of praise. Would you do that? Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. All right. Y'all good? Y'all all right? All right. I'm going to change the order, so if you want to just run back to your seat, I'd appreciate it. Is that all right? Y'all may be seated real quick. Lee didn't know I was going to do this. Lee, you want to give us a story or two, something to make us laugh before we go home? You guys want to hear him do something funny before we go home? My kids are all like, yeah, yeah, do that. So it's Hannah's fault. So blame Hannah right there. And so
when I was in the third grade, my dad was half owner in an auto parts business, McBride's Auto Parts. We had two stores in Columbus, one across the river in Phoenix City, Alabama. My dad comes in, we have a family meeting, and he said, we're going to move to Lakeland, Florida. I've been called to preach, and I'm going to go to Bible college. And our life changed. Before we moved to Lakeland, every morning, I started out with Frosted Flakes. Any other Frosted Flakes fans in the house? I'm a Frosted Flakes or a Peanut Butter Cap'n Crunch guy. I don't like all these new cereals. I like the ones that are the basics. We moved to Lakeland, and we're still eating Frosted Flakes, but the box is different. It's just got a yellow box with two black words, Frosted Flakes. I'm like, where'd Tony go, Daddy? I mean, Tony doesn't like the heat in Florida. What's up? Our life changed. Well, we moved to Florida, and there was a guy who lived down the road from us. Now, he really wasn't any bigger than me, but he was 2 years older than me, and he was a bully. Now, that word kind of gets thrown around a lot, and I want to be let you know, I ain't for any kind of bullying. I ain't for social media bullying. I hate bullies. I don't want any kind of bullying. But back then, when we used the term, he was a physical bully. He threw rocks at me. He pushed my face in an ant bed one time. He would hit me in the head. He was mean. And I was scared to death of him. And he put the word out that if he caught me outside my house, he was going to stomp me. And I'd like to tell you a heroic story of how I put my ankle weights on. Y'all remember ankle weights? And jogged and listened to the theme of Rocky, you know, and came back 2 days later and whooped him. But that is not what happened. I began to dodge him. I mean, you ever seen that Andy Griffith where that guy tells Barney, if I catch you out your uniform, I'm going to whoop you. And Barney just wears his uniform everywhere. That's what I was like. I was scared of him. One day I stepped out the house. I forgot to look to see if he was out there. And he was out there. I guess I wasn't paying attention. This was before they talked about ADD. I guess I had ADD. I know I had two Fs in science and math, but I walked out that front door, and that old boy made a bad mistake. He said something about my mama. Now, kids like to pick on each other's mama, but you can leave my mama out of it. My mama, Bear Bryant, and Dale Earnhardt. Leave them three out of it, or one of us going to get skin up. When he said what he said, all the fear left my body, and I began to tremble with anger. And I put my weight on my back foot and loaded up and swung hard as I could. And I missed his whole head. I missed him. And when he took my momentum and pushed me face down in the dirt, and he got on my back and he was wearing me out. I can still hear the sound effects. Faces in the dirt. Boom. 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 He is killing me. I look up and the whole neighborhood is gathered and watching. And I remember thinking, man, I hope he gets tired in a minute. This is embarrassing. He was working me over. Out of nowhere. I haven't heard a sound like it before or since. It was a metallic sound. And it came from nowhere. And it was building momentum. It was a bizarre, weird sound. All of a sudden, when I heard that sound coming, boom, he flies off of me. And when I looked up, my six-year-old brother had hit him in the head with a pogo stick. Hung a pedal in his ear, drug him off. And we went WWE Monday Nitro on this dude. We're dropping elbows, atomic knee lifts. We choking him out. We wore him out. We beat him like a rented mule right there in the front yard. Now, I don't make fun of the scripture. I've dedicated my life to try to rightly divide the scripture. But there is a scripture in God's word that says, Jesus is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. So if you are spiritually, you ever find yourself spiritually where I was physically, and the enemy's got you down and he's wailing on you, don't just hope that he'll quit. Remember this. Jesus is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. He's got a pogo stick, and he will knock the devil off you. Thank y'all so much. God bless you. I love you.
Come on, stand up with me, would you? I hope you've enjoyed Lee, and we always do. We love him, and always a pleasure to have him in our church. So come on, lift your hands with me. Lord, we are so thankful that we can mount up with wings. Oftentimes we get clogged up. Oftentimes we get wore out. But Lord, we can use the rock to sharpen our talons, to clean that exhaust and help us breathe and help us see better. Lord, let us get our eyes on you and soar straight to you. We love you. We give you praise. Continue to move in this place, and we'll give you glory. And everybody say good amen. Amen. God bless you. We love you. And we will see you.